You must have been blown away by the success of both the album and the tour.
Yeah, I think it was, you never expect anything, you go into the studio and you do the best you can, and, we know we had a hardcore set of fans out there, but when we went out, I think, but the wonderful thing was there was a new generation of fans there, the crowd, kids from 5 to people 75, all coming to rock and roll, which was great, and the album was just worked great. We went to the studio, we had a good time, we didn't have to think about anything, and there wasn't any pressure. We'd been about 6 years or something, hadn't it? So we had a good time, we just relaxed, and so it was brilliant. I mean, I've got to thank everybody, for making it what it was.
It was an 8-year absence between albums, and that was quite well noted, quite well documented. What were you doing? What were you doing for those 8 years?
Well, it's been a bit of time. Riding, of course. But then you have other things in between. We had a change of record company, so that took a while to get sorted out. And then you also had, Cliff, he'd had an accident with his hand, so, he had to have a medical for that. And you want everyone to be ready to go. But when we... actually had everything together, all the songs and everything, it was pretty much, as soon as we got in the studio, it was pretty quick. It was 6 weeks, wasn't it?
Yeah, six, 7 weeks.
And we were in and out. It wasn't a lengthy process. I know it's a bit of time in between, but,
But as a fan, I think maybe when 2 years became 4 years, there was sort of a sense that, well, are they coming back at all? The plan was always that AC/DC were going to return,
Oh, absolutely. It was just, you've got to remember, before that, we'd been playing since Back in Black. I don't think we stopped. It was, maybe 6 months off and then back into the studio and then a tour.
Yeah.
A few months off. So it was like about 22 years non-stop touring, it was good just to recharge the batteries and all that. But as Angus said, Cliff really did. He had to have microsurgery. He didn't really. We didn't know if he was ever going to play again. It was that serious. And so thankfully, everything worked out great for him.
You say though that the 8 year gap was all right. A sizable chunk, but actually when you got into the studio things happened very, very quickly. How do AC/DC record? Are you almost in studio a semi sort of live band? You record it as very much a live album?
It's pretty much you get we do it kind of the old way, we get in there and everyone's there. Brian's even chanting a lot. We put him in a separate box. You got to, right? You got his own little
put
box.
Put it away for the weekend. Yeah. Until I get ready.
Until it's safe, And, when we get in there and we just do it, pretty much live. And then, get the best take, And that's basically it, And we've always pretty much done that way.
It was funny when we were doing it this time, because the producer Brendan O'Brien, he said to me, he said, "You don't like these singing booths, do you?" I said, "I hate them. I always feel like I'm not part of it, because all you can see is a little square hole, and you can see everybody laughing and having a grand time in the control room." And they're going, "I'm going, has anybody?" He said, "I tell you what," he said, "why don't I put you in this office?" So he put us into this little office behind the reception desk of the studio.
So he brings a big key and gets the chains and takes them off his hat.
And all I had was this great big mic in my hand, no headphones, and just these two tiny little speakers, and he'd run down with what the boys had done and stick it on.
I thought you were going to say these two tiny guitarists.
And I remember one day I'm chanting away, I'm shouting, and you could see the pizza delivery boys going, walking, because it wasn't soundproof. And then one
what
day,
are you doing in the pizza pile?
This guy brought his Alsatian in, and he didn't like the sound of my voice at all, and he started jumping up and barking, and I was going, "Jesus Christ, would you get..." But it was fun. What a sound it was. But it was fun. It was just like the early days, when you're making do and having a ball doing it, And it was just, it was a grand old feeling, and it just seemed to whip past so quickly. When Brendan O'Brien said to me, "You're done." And I went, what? And I thought that was it. I thought I'd got me marching orders, but now the album was done.
And is this why you know there is still plenty of life in the band yet? Because, you know, you both have this real glint in your eye. You clearly enjoy being part of this band. I mean, hell, you even enjoy days like today when you got to sit down and answer questions like the ones I'm giving you.
Hey, listen, it's better than the alternative, nobody being interested in you at all. But no, it's part of the fun, and you know, and it's a way of connecting with the fans. And me and Ang aren't exactly a natural, you know, gifted interviewees, but we try to give out as best as we can, and it's a way of connecting with the fans and telling them what we think, of what's happening, and it is fun in a kind of way. It's a pain in the ass, but it's fun.
I guess a lot of people are concerned that you guys are going to take again another 8 years to come back with the follow up. You were on the road for a hell of a long time. I guess there was nights where you'd sit down and maybe work on some new songs, come up with new ideas. Is that follow up to Black Ice? Is that already work in progress? What can you tell us about that?
Yeah, well, you don't stop. We finished touring, and then it's like, for myself, I just keep, churning out ideas. Malcolm's the same, he churns out ideas. And hopefully, fingers crossed, you get it out quick, and we get everything, and then we'll be out there again, I suppose.
Is there a fear of going back out on the road again? I mean, last time it was, 2 years? Million people.
I think if you prepare yourself, I'm not afraid of going out there. I'm absolutely not. That's part of that's the fun bit, the travelling bit.
Fearless,
you're strong like bull.
Strong.
But the travelling is tedious. But the stagey bit.
Well, that mule.
But the stagey bit, getting on the stage, that's the fun bit. That's what you're going out for. I would welcome it. To get out there. I mean, if they said another 2 years, I might blanch a bit, but I think everybody in the band is fit, well prepared. They've still got this, the passion for it, and this is still working, kind of.
So Brian, Angus, the Black Ice tour, was that the biggest in terms of both the size and the scale that AC/DC had ever attempted?
Was that the biggest?
I think figure-wise, numbers-wise, things, and length-wise, I think it probably was the biggest. Yeah. But we didn't really realize when we went out it was going to be that long. It just kept adding. It just kept adding gigs, and the demand was there. So we just kept on going, because it does take a lot to get a show. Like, I was up and running. There's a lot of personnel. I think it was 120 personnel, including drivers and us and everything. That's an awful lot of people, big old army of people, it was great for the crews now that they had a steady gig, which is, in this business, you never know when you're off and on and all that. So it was really good for everybody, and we enjoyed it the heck out of it,
And how do you guys travel around? What's the sort of the setup? Is it buses? Is it planes?
Five camels.
No. Well, we're very lucky this time. We had a plane. We never had a plane before. Even with other bands, but such was the scale of the travelling and all that. We had to have one, or we would never made some of the gigs. So we had a plane, and which was a lot of fun. Sometimes. I remember some of the storms will flow through. Jesus.
When you watch the DVD or the Blu-ray of Live at River Plate, you see this incredible set, and I kind of wonder whether anyone has ever said to you, guys, these ideas, we can't do this. You physically can't take this kind of set around the world. Has anyone ever said to you, no?
No, this is rock and roll. There's no such word as no. There's just no such word. You can do it, And we were very lucky to have a man called Patrick Woodruff, who, when the boys put the, it was Mal and Ang's idea with the train, initially, trying to think of a train and just say to somebody, right, we want a train. and to convert that into the real thing.
You can dream what you want, but you know something's got to be practical. So mm-hmm. you have to see what they come up with you know, what's practical and what's going to look good, you know, because sometimes you can come up with great ideas and you know, and you put them into practice and you go, well, shit, that looks naff, you know. So
yeah, but he's, you know, we did do it, and it was, it really was, it's